Okay, please close the door. Good morning, students. Today we are going to discuss the general surgery, the long questions of the exam 2009. You see, the whole purpose of this exercise is to make you confident of writing the answer, because there are so many things we know, but we don't have a time how much you have to present. So that is why knowledge plus presentation and handwriting, everything does matter. Whatever you write to find out, it must be very clear, it should be underlined, all the headings should be clear. Okay, and in your headings you give the idea to the examiners how much you know about the subject. Okay, so go to 2009. The questions are usually simple plus difficult both, because they are going to judge the basic, advanced and very advanced, the student's capacity, his must know, desirable to know and nice to know. That is how the questions are framed. So our first question we start with is regarding the salivary gland tumors. Okay, the question is, classify salivary gland tumors. Describe etiology, pathology, clinical features, investigation, management. I think they have asked everything regarding pleomorphic adenoma. To start with the salivary glands, a basic anatomy, basic understanding of the salivary gland. There are two parotid glands, one on each side, two submandibular glands, one on each side below the mandible, so called submandibular, two sublingual, sublingual means below the tongue, on both sides, two sublingual, and remaining multiple minor salivary glands. Their total goes to 800 or more. Okay, so this is how the anatomy, and which of the glands are more commonly involved. So we have to go for salivary gland tumors frequency and distribution. Remember, the major glands are usually undergoing adenoma or carcinoma. So major location and type is regarding parotid, submandibular, sublingual. Amongst them, parotid most common frequency, submandibular uncommon, and sublingual very rare. The chances of malignancy, parotid 10 to 20%, more you go for uncommon 50%, very rare more likely to be malignant. Minor salivary glands are usually situated in upper erogastric tract. They are rare, but if they occur, usually malignant. So remember, for all practical purposes, the moment you talk of salivary glands, you are either talking of a parotid or you are talking of a submandibular salivary gland. This is for certain. They may ask parotid or submandibular gland. So how do you classify? This is somewhat difficult, though it is simplified. But remember only few things. Classification of salivary gland. Always remember, adenoma, carcinoma, lymphoma, secondary tumor. This go everywhere. Any organ of the body will have these classifications. Particularly salivary, adenoma divided into two groups, in parotid, commonest is pleomorphic, second common is monomorphic. And the examples are pleomorphic adenoma and adenolymphoma, which is also called as Warthin's tumor. Carcinomas are usually two types, either low grade or high grade. Low grade acinic cell carcinoma, low grade mucoepidermoid carcinoma and adenoid cystic. Very difficult to remember. Remember only acinic cell carcinoma. Okay, high grade, this is probably more important, and it is adenocarcinoma. When the adenocarcinoma comes, squamous cell carcinoma is always there. So these two names you can always write. And particularly for this type of salivary gland, it is a mucoepidermoid carcinoma. This is a high grade tumor and carries very low survival. 5 year survival is very poor in high grade mucoepidermoid carcinoma. So adenoma, carcinoma. Then comes non-epithelial tumors. Comparatively rare, but commonest are hemangioma, lymphangioma. Anywhere non-epithelial tumors, hemangioma, lymphangioma. Okay, lymphomas. lymphomas are common everywhere in the body. Commonest are non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and regarding this salivary gland, it is Sjögren's syndrome. This is also coming as a short note, and they are lymphomas. Unfortunately, they are secondary lymphoma. Secondary tumors do occur in salivary. Where they come from? Head and neck, skin and bronchus. Unclassified tumors are there, very difficult to find out. The lesions which simulate tumor are benign lymphoepithelial adenoid and salivary gland cyst. So this is how you have to classify the salivary glands. Common is adenoma, carcinoma, non-epithelial, lymphoma, secondary. Okay, so we'll go to next. This is a better classification, more simplified. You can go through this, it is easy to understand. They are classified basically as epithelial tumors, non-epithelial tumors. Simple classification. You say epithelial tumors, they can be either adenoma or they can be carcinoma. Amongst adenomas, pleomorphic adenoma, monomorphic adenoma, that is Warthin, adenoid lymphoma is another name, and axophil adenoma. Three types of adenoma. Malignancy, that is carcinoma, low grade carcinoma, high grade carcinoma. So simple. High grade means adenocarcinoma, squamous cell, mucoepithelioma. If non-epithelial tumors, very simple. Hemangioma, lipoma, lymphoma, neurofibroma, whatever. Last comes MA, you add it. It is non-epithelial tumor. Anywhere in the body I am talking. The moment last it is MA, it is a non-epithelial tumor. Regarding non-epithelial tumor, other types, metastatic tumors. But for practical purposes, remember, most common benign tumor of a salivary gland is pleomorphic adenoma, that is a mixed parotid tumor. Most malignant in parotid particularly, it is a mucoepidermoid carcinoma. This is for MCQ also. So what is the distribution of benign and malignant? Parotid, commonest are benign, 80%. Only 20% malignant. So the God is great. Submandibular, 50-50. Nobody knows whether it is malignant or benign. Sublingual, occurs rarely, but 95% malignant chance. And all other minor tumors, they stand 90% chance of a malignancy. So parotid malignancy is comparatively rare. Now this is for us, parotid gland. And now what are the etiologies? Frankly speaking, for these parotid tumors, it is the idiopathic etiology. Etiology is rarely known, but it is there. Predisposing causes to define, it is a smoking. Smoking is one of the factors for Warthin's tumor and mucoepidermoid tumor, not for mixed parotid, okay. And radiation. What is this radiation? Few people undergo treatment for malignancy and they are likely to develop the pleomorphic adenoma. Remember, in all radiation, parotid is most commonly involved. Okay, so now there is no radiation like what it was on the Hiroshima Nagasaki. Well, you can forget about that part. Sorry for this. Sorry. I am taking lecture. Lecture around. Pathology commonest, mixed. Why it is called mixed? Because mixed parotid tumor has got mesenchymal plus epithelial components. Okay, mixed parotid tumor, mesenchymal plus epithelial components. Capsule is well defined. Then how it is growing? It is growing by pseudopodes along with the capsule in the adjacent tissue. It is not the infiltration, it is a pseudopode. It slowly touches the other organs. Common age 40 years. Most common in females. Where it is most commonly seen? In the tail of parotid gland. So, this tumor arises usually in tail of parotid, benign mixed parotid pleomorphic adenoma. What it present like? Tumor lift the ear lobules. What it obliterates? Retromandibular groove. This is regarding anatomy, you must know it. One important sign is there, positive Curtin sign. What this sign is? Inability to move the gland above the zygomatic bone. Why here? Because diff fatty has attached here. So you the parotid cannot go above this curtain. The curtains are closed here. Okay, it is called as a positive curtain sign. When do we suspect malignancy? One, facial nerve involvement, a rapid enlargement of the gland, and ulceration. Always common. Anywhere signs of malignancy, same thing. Rapid enlargement, ulceration, hemorrhage, induration. Enlargement into cervical group. And for a parotid, it is a trismus. Trismus suggests what? Invasion of a masseter muscle by a deep parotid lobe malignancy. Malignancies are more common in deeper lobe than superficial lobe. Okay. So, pleomorphic adenoma. You have to write down detail. Commonest of all, more common in parotids, it is both. Grossly contains, pathologically, it contains cartilage, cystic spaces and solid tissue. Write down this. Microscopically, biphagic. Biphagic what? Epithelial plus stromal components. Histologically, epithelial and myoepithelial cells. What does it show as? Pseudopod. Because of that, it extends beyond the main limit. And whenever this also extends into deeper lobe, it is called as a dumbbell tumor. That means dumb inside and bell on both sides. Dumbbell tumor. Superficial plus deep lobe involvement. Okay. So, amongst all this, remember, it is a containing cartilage, cystic spaces and solid. Epithelial and stromal component. This is the pathology. Okay. Clinical features we have just discussed. Swelling, pain, ulceration, dysphagia. When does dysphagia occurs? Either malignancy or involvement of a deep lobe. A raised ear lobe, curtain sign. Facial nerve, skin, lymph node involvement. And it present usually as a painless, smooth, firm, lobulated, mobile swelling in front of the parotid with a positive curtain sign. This is diagnostic of a parotid tumor. And obliteration of a retinomandibular groove. This is too much. Remember, swelling, pain, ulceration, dysphagia, raised earlobe, curtain sign, and smooth, firm, lobulated swelling. It is what? It is elevating the earlobe. This is the most important sign of a parotid, rather diagnostic. Now, question comes, which of them? The commonest are pleomorphic and Warthin tumor. Both tumors are common. Can we clinically differentiate? Yes. What? How do you differentiate? See the incidence. For all practical purposes, pleomorphic adenoma is 80% common. As against Warthin's only 10%. So, probability of you facing a parotid tumor more likely to be pleomorphic unless proved otherwise. Second thing is very simple. If you are presented with a female patient with pleomorphic parotid swelling, be sure it is pleomorphic. And if it is a male patient, think of Warthin's. Number, if it is a single tumor in female, it is pleomorphic. Multicentric, mainly in males, Warthin tumor. Location, parotid tumor mixed, tail of parotid. Warthin tumors, lower lobe. See, everything is clear, classified. How could you differentiate? Clinical features, mixed parotid is nodular and firm. As against Warthin's, smooth and cystic. T99 scan, advanced investigation. It is a cold spot for a pleomorphic, hot spot for Warthin's. Treatment, see, everything is covered. You write this much, I think more than enough. Treatment. Superficial parotidectomy is the only option in parotid, mixed parotid, that is pleomorphic adenoma. And in Warthin tumors, this is enucleation can be tried, if not parotidectomy. So, if you remember this graph, you can write short note on pleomorphic adenoma. You can also write a short note on Warthin tumor. So, we have compared both. So, this I think you should have with you. Whenever you get a time, read it carefully. So, treatment. Treatment is simple because it is a surgery. Surgery is practically first and last type of treatment. And for a mixed parotid, superficial parotidectomy is a rule. Why superficial? Because the gland is superficial to facial nerve. God has given us a chance to preserve facial nerve. Whenever we damage it, it is our fault. So one of the major complications of a parotid surgery is either impairment or cutting division of a facial nerve. And other complications like Sjögren syndrome, Frese syndrome. Rest is hematoma formation, infection, sloughing of the incision, because incisions are very large. So primary aim is identify and preserve facial nerve. Radiotherapy, very rarely, recurrence unfortunately 5%, and the diagnosis is by FNAC. Remember, FNAC is diagnostic for all parotid tumors, and we have to avoid. Remember, open biopsy has to be avoided. Why? Chances of injury to facial nerve. Never take it lightly. And more important, it is a parotid fistula formation. This is a subcutaneous gland. So, any opening of the duct, trauma to the duct, will cause parotid fistula. So, biopsy has to be avoided. Right. So, we have considered everything regarding the mixed parotid glands, I am sure. Though it looks very difficult, we have made it simplified and write down. Parotid gland, pleomorphic adenoma is commonest, most common in females, most common as a single nodule, most common treatment is superficial parotidectomy. Okay. Signs are lifting of earlobe, curtain size for nodular mobile. Okay. So, you are through in parotid. Next comes very common question. In fact, you must have been taught about it in all branches, and it is amoebic liver abscess. Very commonly asked, very common in usually poor patients, and very common presentation of a liver is with the liver abscess in alcoholic patients. So, these first two pages, please go through them carefully. And you will know everything regarding the amoebic liver abscess, what you are supposed to write. In essence, about amoebic liver abscess, liver is most common site for abdominal visceral abscesses. This is the universal truth, because all the venous drainage goes through portal vein. Okay, that is why everything can lodge into liver. Liver is a common site for abscess, and liver is a common site for secondaries. More common in Asians, because this is a tropical disease, not very common in Western population. Okay, it does not have a gender difference. Male, female equally affected, but males are asking for it by alcohol. Otherwise, there is no difference. Associated comorbidities, more common in male, cirrhosis and chronic renal failure. The causative agent, Entamoeba histolytica. The root is ficoral root. Trophozoite reach liver through portal venous system. Because of that, it is usually or more or most common in right lobe. Fortunately, usually solitary. Low incidence of invasive amoebiasis in menstruating women. So, do not diagnose amoebic liver abscess in menstruating young woman. That gives protection itself. And majority are patients who asked for abscess because of alcohol, that is young men. Particularly malnourished comorbid patients are presenting with amoebic liver abscess. And most common invasive disease which affects colitis, cecum and ascending colon. Understand? So, these are the, in short, the etiology and pathology. In colon, they are flask shaped ulcers. Clinical features, most common abdominal pain. Age 20 to 40 years. Patient may be having signs of colitis like fever, malaise and chills. Anorexia. And most important, right upper quadrant pain. The patient may or may not give history of diarrhea. This is uncommon. Jaundice, not very common. But what is most common LFT abnormality? Always remember, it is prothrombin time in amoebic liver abscess. Okay, now diagnosis. We are writing a full question, understand. Diagnosis done by USG and CT. How do you confirm it? ELISA test. Cultures usually negative or sterile. X-ray chest, elevated hemidiaphragm. In addition, right-sided pleural effusion or atelectasis, that is the consolidation of lobe. A reddish brown uncovy sauce pus is diagnostic on aspiration. And here, rather than color, the typical odor is most diagnostic of amoebic liver abscess. So, you have written everything about amoebic liver abscess. So, treatment. Mainstay of the treatment is conservative. Drug of choice, metronidazole, 750 mg, TID for 10 to 14 days. Remember, most of the drugs for a GI tract are 10 to 14 days, including PPI. And also including anti-H. pylori drugs. To prevent recurrence, luminal agent like dalamine furoate. But more thing, radiological resolution takes 3 to 9 months. That means you should not be confused. Even though the abscess has improved, there is no abscess pus inside. But radiologically, it is a 3 to 9 months. So what is the treatment if this is not responding? That means indication for aspiration. Ideally, aspiration has to be avoided in amoebic liver abscess. Write down that. Very sure. When aspiration indicated, diagnostic uncertainty means you are not sure whether this is amoebic abscess or not. Failure to respond in 3 to 5 days. This is very important. That means patient must respond to metronidazole. Associated pyogenic superinfection and higher risk of rupture. When thrips is more, the rupture risk is more if the size is more than 5 cm. All the abscess in left lobe, because it is rare, aspiration is warranted. And in pregnancy aspiration is associated or advised because you cannot give metronidazole, which is inappropriate during pregnancy. Treatment is over. Complications, most common rupture in peritoneum or in pleural cavity, or very rarely pericardium. So in pleural cavity, it is itself is a treatment. Laparotomy, rarely indicated. When indicated, doubtful cases of perforation, sepsis and hemorrhage. These are the only indications for laparotomy. A rupture in the bronchus itself is a treatment. It is self-limited, and postural drainage with bronchodilator is the treatment of choice. Okay, so we have finished regarding the amoebic liver abscess. You write down this much, very good. You are the best student. Now, for everybody like me, we have to discuss in detail about amoebic liver abscess. We know the baseline. Now, just some beautification. Okay. Common in tropical countries. Entema vesicularis parotid. Alcohol and cirrhosis are causes. Not common in female in menstruating age. Anchovy sauce. And most important risk factor is the size. Above 5 cm, aspiration. Below 3 cm, it is only and only medical treatment. What is the pathology? They are all infected from rectosigmoid or ileocecal region. Okay, because of a direct continuation of inferior mesenteric vein to portal vein. Because of portal vein clarity, straight line. Most of them resolve on its own. Because there are localized amoebic abscess. 80% single abscess. 20% multiple. More common, right posterior, because what is called as a streamline effect. Portal vein is in direct continuation with the right branch. So, it is the direct effect. They can be multilocated. Okay. Pus is classically Ankovisos. And one thing, Ankovisos pus microscopically does not contain WBCs. The color sometimes may be green due to bile. It contains what? Dead liver cells, RBCs and necrotic material. Here the Entamoeba histolytica are eating your own liver. That is why these changes. But WBC is not there because there is no reaction. Okay. Clinical features. Again, if you want, you can write down in detail. History of dysentery may not be there or may be there. Patient may give attack of amoebic dysentery. Common in males, 10:1. Clinical presentation, fever, loss of weight, chill strikers, cough, shoulder pain because of irritation of a diaphragm and pain in right hypochondrium, which is 30%. Intercostal tenderness, this is a beautiful sign, you can always elicit it clinically. In a liver abscess, intercostal tenderness is always there. Few patients may have a right-sided pleural effusion. And associated to that, tenderness, there is a skin edema. This is a beautiful sign for an amoebic liver abscess. Skin edema in right hypochondrium is diagnostic of amoebic liver abscess. Okay. Now, what are the types? It can be acute with chills and rigors. It can be chronic, which will present as a hard and firm non-tender mass. Okay. This is a chronic phase. The features may be all different types. It may be only systemic like fever, chills and rigors. Abdominal symptoms, pain, tenderness, guarding, rigidity and mass. Thoracic presentation, dry cough, chest pain, shoulder pain, pleural effusion, intercostal tenderness. So, acute and chronic presentation, local, systemic, abdominal, thoracic. These are the different presentation. Investigations. Commonest is WBC. Total leukocyte count. Many of these patients have anemia, more than 50%. Liver function altered bilirubin in some cases. But diagnosis is prothrombin time is widened. PT is prolonged. And what you should do, whenever there is a PT prolonged, these patients require vitamin K injection for 5 days before surgery. Okay, then this is, if suppose it is not responding, patient need fresh frozen plasma. And the diagnosis is by USG abdomen, which shows altered echogenicity. It is the 90% sensitive. It is unechogenic, hypoechogenic. Chest X-ray finding, raised fixed diaphragm, plus minus pleural effusion. Okay, this is the investigation. Now, this chart also, if possible, try to remember. This is giving you the differential diagnosis from the amoebic liver abscess to pyogenic liver abscess. This is a common differential diagnosis. And pyogenic liver abscess may itself be asked as a short note. So, how are they differentiated? Most common symptom, amoebic, pain abdomen. Pyogenic, fever. Not only fever, fever plus jaundice, plus right upper quadrant pain. These go in favor of a pyogenic liver abscess. Most common sign, hepatomegaly in amoebic. Tenderness in pyogenic. Lesion single in 80% amoebic. Very commonly multiple in 50% in pyogenic. So multiple liver abscess, always think of a pyogenic liver abscess. Age, younger age group, 20 to 40. Older age group, more than 15 pyogenic because the resistance has come down. Male, female, male 10:1 for amoebic and equally distributed almost in pyogenic. Diabetes. Diabetes is surprisingly very rare in amoebic liver abscess. What is the cause? We don't know. But it is more common in pyogenic liver abscess. So, diabetics are more prone for pyogenic liver abscess. LFT. most common abnormality. In amoebic we have studied, it is raised PT. And in case of pyogenic, it is elevated ALP, that is alkaline phosphatase. PT raised, alkaline phosphatase raised. This is also differentiation. Jaundice, rare in amoebic, comparatively common in pyogenic. Blood culture, negative, positive. Amoebic serology, serological test, it is common in amoebiasis, it is negative in pyogenic. Okay. CT scan, this itself is a differential diagnosis. What it says? In amoebic, it is a hypodense, well-defined margins with no peripheral rim enhancement. This is a very difficult known more for radiologists. So, their diagnosis they will write down. And there is a peripheral edema. In case of pyogenic, same hypodense, but gas is produced inside. And here margins are irregular. In amoebic, margins are regular. In pyogenic, peripheral rim enhancement is positive, which was negative in amoebic liver abscess. If somebody asks you, you should be able to tell this. Okay. Treatment as usual, the treatment drug of choice, metronidazole, tinidazole and antibiotics. In our days, chloroquine was a drug of choice. But now chloroquine causes so many problems, so chloroquine is avoided. So what is the treatment official format? Oral flagyl 750 mg TID. Sometimes patient do need injection emetine. It has got its own problems. It should be under guidance and a cardiovascular follow. For a recurrence or a carrier state, it is idoquinol or dioxazonide furoate. Remember, small abscess less than 3 cm always respond to drugs. So, when do you advise therapeutic aspiration, which is usually avoided because 90% cases are responding to metrogyl. So, what are the indications for therapeutic aspiration? Most common, risk of rupture. When there is more risk, when diameter is more than 5 cm. Abscess in left lobe of liver and diagnostic uncertainty. Add to that, if the patient is not responding to metronidazole within 3-5 days, and in pregnancy you have to aspirate. Most common complication, rupture. Most common site of rupture, peritoneum. May rupture into bronchus. Here it is self-limiting and treatment is bronchodilator plus a posterior drainage. This is regarding amoebic liver abscess. So you have understood what to write down regarding amoebic liver abscess. Now the very common question always asked in different format. This time the format is hypovolemic shock. Last time it was septic shock. Before that hemorrhagic shock. Question is same. Only one type is highlighted. Define shock. Discuss classification, clinical monitoring and management of a hypovolemic shock. So everything has been discussed. So we will directly go to hypovolemic shock. What is hypovolemic shock? It is low volume shock. Commonest cause, hemorrhage due to injury of liver, spleen and bone. Severe bleeding during thyroid, liver or portal vein. And for hypovolemic, is a major cause is vomiting and diarrhea due to any cause. So this chart, causes of a hypovolemic shock. On one side, it is hemorrhagic, in other side it is non-hemorrhagic. For hemorrhagic, we have discussed trauma, surgeries, malignancies or major fractures or during major surgery like thyroid liver. Non-hemorrhagic, dehydration, vomiting, diarrhea, diabetes, how it will cause? Due to urinary loss. In burns, what happens? The fluid is evaporated and in rare cases where there is what is called as third space loss. Where does it occur? That means fluid is taken out of circulation. That is the third space loss. Intracellular, extracellular and third space. It occurs in acute pancreatitis, that means necrosis pancreatitis and intestinal bowel obstruction. So these are the causes of a non-hemorrhagic shock. Okay. So what is hypovolemic shock? How they can present? Usually it is commonest for us mild, that means less than 50% loss. It is called as a covert compensated hypovolemia. Okay, there will not be any significant change and the blood pressure, heart rate remains common. Why? Because splanchnic blood is diverted to vital organs. It is same like hemorrhaging. First is covert. Second is overt. Overt means now the expression has come. Cause is loss from 15% to 40%. It is overt. Here patient has got cold extremity, tachycardia and tachypnea, confusion. Confusion is important sign. And always remember it is acidosis, metabolic acidosis. And this patient present with postural hypotension. So if a patient shock tries to get up, he will get again into hypotension. Third is decompensated hypovolemia. What it is? Whenever their loss is more than 40%. All the features plus tachycardia and eventually it will go to SIRS. SIRS is always a, everywhere you go into body, SIRS, systemic inflammatory response syndrome. This is how the body reacts to anything wrong in the body. And if not treated on time, it will lead to irreversible shock and MODS. Okay. This is regarding the hypovolemic shock. And this page, you should try to remember. Commonest cause for hypovolemic shock is also anaphylactic shock. Because the blood is pooled. They are basically distributive shocks. Two distributive shocks. Hypovolemic shock because of fluid and anaphylactic shock. Okay. And more important, septic. Septic shock is also distributive shock. Sudden onset in distributive shock, bronchospasm, rash and hypotension and feeble pulse. Unfortunately, mortality is 10% in anaphylactic shock. Never underestimate. This is the cause of major problems in a practice where patient is known or we do not ask for any reaction to drug. And that is a surprise for yourself as well as for the family of patient. And major cause for allegation on the hospitals and doctors. So be aware of anaphylactic shock. How to treat? The base is adrenaline. Adrenaline must be available in your box. Okay. This is called as a crash cart. IV, oxygen and foot end elevation. Cardiac massage, defibrillation. This is anaphylactic shock. Never forget the management of anaphylactic shock. So, what are the clinical features of hypovolemic shock? Simple. Two stages. Early, late stage. Early stage, tachycardia, sweating, cold periphery. Late stage, very late, cyanosis, anuria, jaundice and drowsiness. Okay. This is a general phenomenon. Clinically, shock may be compensated where nothing is seen, but remember, there is a mild lactic acidosis. Lactic acid plays a major role. Always I have been telling you regarding shock. In mild shock, mild lactic acidosis, tachycardia, tachypnea. Moderate shock, significant lactic acidosis, decreased output, tachypnea, drowsiness and mild hypotension. That is moderate. Severe, severe lactic acidosis, anuria, tachypnea. And profound hypertension associated with unconsciousness. This is a clinical feature of a hypovolemic shock. So how do you assess all that? You have to monitor regularly TPR, that is temperature, pulse, respiration, plus BP and heart rate, and urine output you have to manage hourly for a shock. And urine output should be more than 0.5 ml per kg per hour. Pulse ox should be always there. CVP, PCWPP. Serum lactate estimation is an important prognostic factor. And what is the level? Any level of more than 2 milliequivalents per liter, it suggests tissue ischemia. So serum lactate estimation is a must. More than 2 milliequivalents per liter suggests tissue ischemia. and you have to go for investigation to find out the cause, like USG, MRI, CT, all blood investigations, and ABG. ABG is very important, arterial blood class plus PT. So this is how you investigate. So what is the treatment? Common guidelines. Treatment of shock, if done in a proper time, immediately, it is life saving. So what is the principle? Treat the cause, improve cardiac function, and improve tissue perfusion of what? Oxygen. So IV fluid and oxygen are mainstay. Stabilize patient with initial resuscitation. After that, go for evaluation. So initial resuscitation with IV and oxygen is a must. So what is it? Initial acute critical care management. What it is? A, B, C, D, E. A stands for airway, B for bleeding, C for circulation, D for drugs or disability, whatever is caused, and E for exposure. That means you have to remove the patient from the exposure of cause of hypotension. That is equally important. If suppose patient is bleeding, no point. You have to take care of the bleeding itself. That is treat the cause in any shock. Septicemia, you have to remove or drain the pus. Principles of fluid replacement, either it is a colloid or crystalloid. Initially crystalloid, then colloid. And last comes blood transfusion. What is the fluid therapy with crystalloid? It is normal saline, Ringer, Hartmann solution. But remember, nowadays change has occurred. Hypotonic solution like dextrose in saline are poor volume expanders and should not be used in shock. So giving even 5% dextrose or even giving DNS, this practice has to be abandoned. You can study a dynamic fluid response. How it is done? 500 ml of warm normal saline. So drug of choice for crystalloid to us is normal saline or RL. This should be used within 10 minutes to see the response of patient. The response is there, we are dealing with a hypovolemia. Okay, this is a dynamic fluid response. Then comes dopamine, dobutamine, correction of acid-base balance, acidosis, lactic acidosis. How do you correct it? Corrected by 8.4% soda bicarb intravenously. All the time the physician gives soda bicarb, push soda bicarb. This is life saving. So soda bicarb also should be available on your table, on a crash cart. Steroids are life saving. Maybe use 500 to 1000 hydrocortisone. Patient must be catheterized for urine output. Nasal oxygen must CVP line whenever you need for a longer time and adequate. TPN whenever required. Then pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, very critical patient. Hemodialysis may be required. And pain has to be controlled because pain is a common cause for even shock. The pain must be controlled. Okay, so we have covered everything regarding the types of shock and hypovolemic shock. So happy with this. Next is a question which is sometimes asked, not commonly discussed. What it is? Discuss hiatus hernia types, clinical features, complications and management. This is a hiatus hernia, not very commonly asked. But for all practical purposes, hiatus means it is sleeping hernia. Hiatus is opening. Opening between two spaces, hiatus slowly going. And where this hiatus lying? Between a chest and abdominal cavity. There is a hiatus through which major structures come into abdomen. Those are all the arteries, veins, and esophagus. So these are the major structures which are coming out from the chest through the diaphragm. This is a normal diaphragmatic opening. And hiatus hernia means whenever the herniation occurs through this natural opening. And here always commonest presentation is GORD or GERD. What it is? Gastroesophageal reflux disorder. This is also a long question asked, GERD. Nowadays, we don't talk of ulcer, we talk of GERD, mainly in adult and old age. What is this? Herniation is, or GOD is equal to, it is due to, again, you remember this page, loss of competence of LOS or LES. It is lower esophageal sphincter. There is a sphincter into hiatus which maintains the pressure so that the content of abdomen do not go into chest. Peristalsis is from above to below. So, this back pressure is prevented by lower esophageal sphincter. And this GERD is a most common presentation. Usually are associated with hiatus hernia. What are the types? Sliding is commonest, less common, rolling, that is paraesophageal, and third is mixed. Most common symptom, heartburn, epigastric discomfort, and regurgitation. Regurgitation is common, bad, that is regurgitation. This symptom is made worse by stooping and lying. Patient is comfortable standing or sitting. The moment he stoops forward, that means while washing your mouth also, teething, you get a pain. And whenever you lie down, you will also have a reflux. There is always a confusion between achalasiacardia and GORD. They are diagnostic confusion, diagnosed by endoscopy. That means endoscopy is an investigation of choice. Plus, for a hiatus hernia, 24-hour pH of the esophagus is a gold standard for MCQ. What is the gold standard for GERD? 24-hour acid, the pH of the esophagus. Management, primarily medical. And proton pump inhibitor, that is PPIR, most effective. In some cases, surgery may be required. And what is the surgery, TOC, treatment of choice? Laparoscopic fundoplication is a TOC. In rare cases, stricture may develop in hiatus hernia. Then it is a dilatation and stenting. So this is in short everything regarding the hiatus hernia. You remember this page, you are through. For a details, we will go again. Sliding hernia is commonly associated with GORD. What happens here? The cardia is esophagogastric junction. The cardia of the stomach migrates back and forth between the posterior mediastinum and parietal cavity. This is continuous pass, free pass to cardia. Free pass to cardia, go into the mediastinum, come back to parietal cavity. Again go to mediastinum, come back to parietal cavity. This is how on first type. It is a sliding hernia. If suppose the is going more frequently, what will happen? The cardia will be more dilated. The hiatus hernia will be more in size because of the frequent action. Then you go to the next stage, what is called as a rolling hernia. How it differs? Apart from this free passage, the fundus of the stomach directly goes into the chest cavity, the pneumon. So this in addition to rolling. So sliding hernia goes to rolling hernia. And here the stomach part, the fundus of the stomach becomes a permanent residence of a chest cavity. Okay, you are getting the difference, sliding hernia and rolling hernia. So what are the grades? We will discuss afterwards. So this figure, if you remember, it gives an idea about a sliding and a rolling hernia. Okay, and this is how the in detail, sliding hernia, rolling hernia and combined hernia. In sliding, it is the cardia is going up and down. Here, it is permanent residence of chest. Here, both things, going and coming back, and also part of the stomach is there in the cavity. So, these are the different types of hiatus hernia. So, what are the types? Type 1, it is sliding. Commonest, cephalia displacement of a GE junction. Usually small, asymptomatic and reducible. Type 2, rolling hernia. It is the migration of fundus of stomach and esophagus into the mediastinum. What happens here? the GE junction is a normal place in intra-abdominal, but another fronts have gone up because of a more size of a hiatus. Again, side increases more, it is a type 3 hiatus hernia. What it is? It is a combination of one and two types. That means only the GE junction is going up and stomach. Now, the hiatus hernia or hiatus again dilates more. So, what will happen? It is a free passage and occurs type 4 hernia. What happens here? Along with that, it will bring all the fronts of the transverse colon omentum into chest. So, everything from abdomen has gone to chest. And this is a major class type 4 hiatus hernia. Okay. And here you see that the abdomen is empty. Many times it is seen. So, this paper also, this page, please try to remember. Simple. Type 1, sliding hiatus hernia, most common. Type 2, true paraesophageal hernia by the side of esophagus. Type 3, mixed 1 and 2. Type 4, paraesophageal hernia and now containing other intra-abdominal organs. Okay, this is the type. Pathophysiology, what is actually happening? Type 1 or sliding, it is characterized by upward displacement of GE junction in posterior mediastinum. Here, stomach has remained in usual longitudinal alignment. Alignment has not been changed. And one surprise thing, there is a high incidence of a sliding hernia in people with inguinal hernia. What is the cause? I don't know. But inguinal hernia patient who has got, he stands chances of having hiatus hernia. Majority asymptomatic. And prevalence and symptoms depend on the size. Size is determinant for correlation and severity of a GERD. Type 2 hiatus hernia, it is a posterior esophageal hernia. What happens here? The GE junction is normal, but the stomach has gone by the side because it is increased. So, stomach is comparatively mobile part. In fact, the GE junction is almost fixed, but stomach can easily go into chest. So, this is a congenital defect. Remember, type 2 paraesophageal is a congenital defect. Persistent fixation of a GE junction is essential. So, during all surgeries, you have to fix the GE junction and remove the size. Type 3, mixed hernia. Okay. Everything is going to posterior mediastinum. Remember, all these openings are into posterior mediastinum. It starts as a sliding hernia and as hiatus enlarges, more fundus, more body of the stomach herniating into chest. Type 4, more dilatation, hernia sac also contains spleen, colon, small bowel, everything. And it will ultimately lead to what? Bowel obstructions and complications. So, type 4, more prone for complications. This page, I think you remember, you can write down everything regarding hiatus hernia. So, this is in detail about herniation of the stomach content, frequency. What are the common features? First, remember, hiatus hernia, though common in children, newborn, otherwise it is commonest in elderly patient. In elderly, because of a constant regurgitation and age, the hiatus becomes loose. Patient may have abdominal pain, chest pain, hiccups, fullness, early satiety, doesn't feel like eating. Regurgitation, bloating, postprandial, after he eats, the whole gas comes out. Dysphagia, dyspnea, and very rarely, it can present as an acute emergency of perforation, gangrene and bleeding. So, these are all the clinical presentation. Then comes complications. As long as the organs are into stomach, alright. Now, they have encroached. So, what are the complications? Gangrene, gastric volvulus, perforation, either into mediastinum or into peritoneum. And there is a herniation which develops ulcer. So, beauty. Ischemic ulcer over the herniated stomach is called as Cameron ulcer. So, this person was smart enough to find out what ulcer occurs and it is called as a Cameron ulcer. Investigations, simple, plain x-ray, shows air fluid level. Variable ECG CT scan. Treatment always surgical. No medical management. Medical management is elevation of foot head. Surgically, excision of the sac and repair. Treat the gangrene by gastrectomy whenever required. And it is either laparoscopic or open with mesh replacement. So, symptoms are usually due to twisting and distortion of esophagus. There can be many more problems. So, endoscopic appearance usually confusing. So, it has to have orientation. Another hernias, congenital diaphragmatic hernia. This is a different entity in children. It is a retrosternal hernia. It is more anterior, retrosternal. It is called as a Morgagni hernia. Remember for short note. What they are associated with? Increased low receptive pressure and herniation of abdominal organs in chest. So pressure is low in fact, and it occurs into just below the behind the sternum. Common in children, called as a congenital diaphragmatic hernia, CDH. In children, infant, those present with respiratory distress. So for a CDH, what is the clinical type? What the other is? CDH also stands in arthropodic. Here it is a congenital diaphragmatic hernia. And arthropodic, what it is? It is congenital dislocation of hip. So infant has got two CDH. One CDH for diaphragmatic hernia, one CDH for dislocation of hip. The clinical triad, respiratory distress, dextrocardia. Here is heart is on the right side. And scaphoid abdomen. Why scaphoid? Most of the contents of the small void of the abdomen has gone into chest. So it is a scaphoid abdomen. Here you need tension free repair as early as possible, because it is Morgagni is a congenital anteromedial hernia. 90% are right sided because pericotonium prevents left sided hernia. They are usually accidental finding on x-ray. There are no symptoms or symptomatic. Even though prompt surgical repair after diagnosis is a must. Why? All of them will go into incarceration or strangulation of the intestinal content. The route is transabdominal, bring everything down and go for a mesh repair for a CDH. So, all the symptomatic hernias always require surgical repair because they are potentially dangerous. So, no taking lightly. The risk is probably greater than the estimated risk. Patient in emergency may present as an acute chest pain. The first treatment is nasogastrial tube to relieve the distension and then surgery. Sometimes endoscopy is also useful whenever nasogastric intubation is not possible. So, if there is perforation, immediate surgery is required. Elective surgery involves reduction of hernia, excision of sac and reduction of a crural defect between the two cruras of a diaphragmatic opening and fixation of stomach. The laparoscopic fundoplication is treatment of choice. And full anatomical repair of a large rolling hernia can be difficult by this approach. So, many times they require open surgery. Okay. So, we have considered about hiatus hernia. Now, the last question is for us, it is also very common. It is a GOO. Cause, clinical features, diagnosis and management of a GOO. GOO stands for gastric outlet obstruction or gastric outlet syndrome. What it signifies? It signifies obstruction of a gastric outflow at pylorus. What is the gastric inflow? Gastroesophageal junction. What is gastric outflow? It is a duodenopylorus junction. Gastroduodenal junction is pylorus. So this is obstruction to the outflow. And most common cause for this is chronic duodenal ulcer for an outflow at pylorus. Second common being carcinoma of stomach. Remember these two causes, and sometimes congenital pyloric stenosis. So these three are the common causes for GOO. Pyloric stenosis due to chronic duodenal ulcer is the commonest cause. What is the pathology? During years, there is a cicatrization and scarring, which causes the obstruction at pylorus, leading to enormous dilatation of stomach. This is how the you can diagnose pathologically. Clinical features: pain, persistent vomiting in epigastric region, and feeling of fullness. Vomiting, very large quantity, foul smelling, very bad smelling, and vomitus contains food consumed on a previous day, not today. Yesterday's food can be also vomited today, and they are partially digested or undigested food. Periodicity with loss of appetite and weight. This patient become very anemic, marasmic. The clinical sign is VGP. What it is? Visible gastric peristalsis, elicited by asking a patient to drink a cup of water. After that, you will see the visible gastric peristalsis, and they go from left to right. Okay. So, it is a complex entity. It is a clinical and pathophysiological consequence of any disease process that is producing the mechanical impediment. There is no other. In pyloric stenosis, it is not mechanical, but it is related to neurogenic. Here, it is purely mechanical impediment to gastric emptying. The causes can be, for an adult, it can be benign or it can be malignant. And that cause decides the treatment. Okay. So, what are the causes? Etiology. Benign causes. PUD manifests in 5% of all patients within pylorus and first part of duodenum. Gastric polyps, ingestion of caustics. Remember, this caustic poisoning, that acid and alkali. Alkali gives rise to major strictures. Acid burns and perforates. If frankly speaking, alkalis are more bad than acids. Acids can be diluted with the help of water. Alkalis cannot be. This is also important. You must remember, alkalis are more dangerous. Pyloric stenosis, congenital duodenal web. That means some form of diaphragm is there. Gallstone obstruction. What it is? It is called as a Bouverette syndrome. Again, short note. Gallstone obstruction of the duodenum. How it occurs? It is due to opening of a gallbladder into duodenum. From a CBD, stone will come into duodenum. It is a Bouverette syndrome. Pseudocyster pancreas, bezoars, acute setting secondary to inflammation. H. pylori are major cause of GOO. In pediatric, it is a pyloric stenosis. Occurs in 1 into 750 live births. Not very uncommon, very common. And more common in boys than girls. And unfortunately, it is more common in first born children. So, congenital pyloric stenosis, more common in boys and more common first born boy. We always pray for the boy first, and he stands chances for pyloric stenosis. I don't know what it is. Malignant causes, pancreatic cancer is the most common cause. That means pressure from outside. It can occur in 20% of pancreatic carcinoma. Other tumors causing this is a gastric cancer per se, duodenal cancer, ampullary cancer, cholangiocarcinoma, and gastric cancer. There can be metastasis of gastric outlet by the primary. So, this figure from book gives us the anatomical changes associated with pyloric stenosis. On the right side graph, you see beautiful pylorus. On the left side, badly looking scarred pylorus, which is closed. So, this is how, and what is giving? It is giving dilated stomach. Okay. So, pathophysiology is a dilated stomach which occurs due to obstruction of the outflow. Patient may present intermittently, but ultimately it will lead to permanent obstruction. And remember, vomiting is the cardinal symptom. Initially, patient will demonstrate some tolerance to liquid, then solid. Afterwards, everything is stopped. So, pyloric stenosis is the result of ग्रेजुअल हाइपरट्रॉफी ऑफ सर्कुलर स्मूथ मसल्स ऑफ द पाइलोरस। लेटर ऑन सिग्निफिकेंट वेट लॉस। कंटिन्यूस वॉमिटिंग लीड टू वॉट? डिहाइड्रेशन एंड इलेक्ट्रोलाइट एबनॉर्मेलिटीज। अनडाइजेस्टेड फूड इज अ कॉन्स्टेंट रिस्क। रिमेंबर अनडाइजेस्टेड फूड ऑफ टू थ्री ओल्ड एंड पेशेंट वॉमिट्स, इट इज अ कॉन्स्टेंट रिस्क फॉर एस्पिरेशन न्यूमोनिया। प्रॉब्लम इज डायग्नोस्टिक। मेनी टाइम्स वॉट इज द कॉज इज डिफिकल्ट टू डायग्नोज। So first you have to rule out medical causes. There are many causes for constant vomiting like diabetic gastroparesis, pregnancy, psychosomatic disorders. And we have to confirm the mechanical obstruction first. How it is done? We have to diagnose in very very different investigations. Carry out diagnosis and treatment expeditiously because it is a serious condition. And any delay will result in further compromise of a patient's nutritional status. Okay. So what are the features? Because of metabolic problems, irritability, confused status, dehydration. Alkalosis has come into picture. What it is? A rapid breathing. The breathing is called as a chain stroke breathing. You must write down the chain stroke breathing in medicine always. And tetany because of calcium and potassium disturbances, the patient can have a tetany. Investigations, all serum electrolyte, ABG analysis and serum calcium level. The treatment is comparatively simple. You have to infuse normal saline. Sometimes double strength normal saline to slow correction is important. IV potassium is a must. Under ECG monitoring. Again, IV magnesium, IV calcium. The cause has to be treated. Metabolic changes are not severe in carcinoma pylori. See, even carcinoma is bad. It is not giving major metabolic changes in this. Pyelocystinosis, more severe metabolic stage changes. Okay. Carcinoma stomach here, why it is so? If you remember, one of the predisposing or pre malignant cause for a carcinoma stomach is hypochlorohydria or achlorohydria. That means there is no acid secretion to cause all these different changes. Okay. So, clinical signs. Positive succussion flash. On an empty stomach, if you give water for the patient or stomach and you shake the patient, you can hear the intestinal sound. That means the sound of air and gas. It is a succussion flash. Here, the percussion that is called as auscultopercussion test shows dilated stomach. And here, what do you mean by dilatation? Dilation, usually the greater curvature of stomach is above the umbilicus, midway between the umbilicus and epigastrium. And in GOO, it is auscultated below the umbilicus. Electrolyte changes like paradoxical aciduria. There are different tests. So, investigations, again red line, remember barium meal which has got an absence of duodenal cap. Dilated stomach where greater curvature is below and maybe up to the level of iliac crest. This is most diagnostic. Barium will not pass into duodenum. Here we are using a barium which is soluble barium. Gastrographin. Gastroscopy is a must to rule out carcinoma stomach and visualize the stenosis area. Electrolyte study, ECG and differential diagnosis mainly carcinoma pylorus. The differentiation is in carcinoma pylorus, mass may be clinically palpable. So, causes of pyelocystinosis, congenital, chronic, carcinoma pylorus, adult pyelocystinosis. Here treatment is pyloroplasty and sometimes the mucosal diaphragm, that is a web which has to be treated endoscopically. Electrolyte changes, everything is there. Hyponatremia, hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, hypochloremia, metabolic alkalosis and paradoxical aciduria. This paradoxical aciduria, because even there is no acid, the urine is acidic. So, it is called as a paradoxical aciduria. Alkalosis can lead to hypocalcemia. See, 1 into 2. Hypocalcemia is causing tetany. एंड दिस टिटेनी हाइपोकैल्सीमिया ड्यू टू अल्कलोसिस इज कॉल्ड एज गैस्ट्रिक टिटेनी. ओके एंड पैराडॉक्सिकल एसिडोरिया. द ट्रीटमेंट कंपेयर ट्रीटमेंट इज करेक्शन ऑफ डिहाइड्रेशन, करेक्शन ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोलाइट बाय आई वी फ्लूइड एंड कैल्शियम फॉस्फेट मैग्नीशियम सप्लीमेंटेशन, ब्लड ट्रांसफ्यूजन टीपीएन. मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट इज स्टमक वॉश. यू हैव टू वॉश द स्टमक आइदर बाय राइस ट्यूब और द लार्ज स्टमक ट्यूब. दैट स्टमक ट्यूब इज कॉल्ड एज एस्वाल्ड्स ट्यूब. दिस इज वाई इंपॉर्टेंट. यू हैव टू रिड्यूस द एडिमा ऑफ द स्टमक वॉल एंड यू हैव टू इम्प्रूव द गैस्ट्रिक एम्प्टिंग टाइम. एम्प्टी स्टमक विल हैव अ बेटर गैस्ट्रिक मसल टोन. ओके दिस इज अ प्राइमरी मैनेजमेंट. मेनस्टे ऑफ द मैनेजमेंट इज सर्जरी. सर्जरी ऑफ चॉइस इज हाईली सिलेक्टिव वैगोटॉमी विद जीजे. इट इज आइडियल रिकमेंडेशन बट नॉट वेरी कॉमनली डन. कॉमनेस्ट इज ट्रंकल वैगोटॉमी विथ गैस्ट्रोजेनोस्टॉमी. सिंपलेस्ट ऑपरेशन, लोएस्ट कॉम्प्लिकेशन रेट. दिस इज अ ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ चॉइस. समटाइम्स बिलरोथ वन वैगोटॉमी प्लस एंट्रेक्टॉमी विथ बिलरोथ वन एनास्टोमोसिस विद द फीडिंग जेजेनोस्टॉमी. दिस इज ऑल कॉम्प्लिकेटेड. यू रिमेंबर बिलरोथ वन? Whenever the duodenum is anastomosed to the stomach, Billroth 1. Whenever the jejunum anastomosed to stomach, Billroth 2. So here management is conservative, rice tube, IV fluid and ultimately surgery which will bypass the pylorus. Because you cannot remove pylorus or pyloroplasty is not recommended. It is a bypass of the stomach either by a gastrostomy with highly selective vagotomy or jejunostomy with the truncal vagotomy. Okay, this is how we are going to manage the case of this pyloric congenital pyloric stenosis or what you called as a GOO. This brings us to the end of our 2009 question paper. Next time we will consider 2008. Thank you very much. Good day.
Yeah. Thank you.